It's a great day to praise the Lord. Anybody else think it's a great day to praise the Lord? You know, I was talking to somebody coming in. I said, they made this comment. I don't have any complaints. I thought, you know, we really do. If we just want to think about them, we could all complain about something, couldn't we? But why? Why? Because we have more to praise the Lord about than we do to complain about. We really do. So it's a great day to praise the Lord. I am glad you're here. I got to meet so many guests coming in this morning. It seemed like Easter all over again. So many guests. Really, it was just amazing. How many of you, this is your first time to be in a service in this building? Let me see your head. Wave at me, because I got to meet so many of you in every section. You're all over. Welcome. We are glad you're here. I hope when you came in this morning, we put in your hand one of these, and inside of there is what we call our communication card. And I just want to ask our guests to do what our home folks do. And we fill this out every week. It gives us a record of our attendance, but it gives you a way to tell me how I can pray for you this week. So would you just get that ready and put your prayer request at the bottom? We'll collect those at the end of the service this morning, but I am excited that you're here. You know, one thing I know for sure is that none of us are going to be around here forever, right? Because this world is not our home. We're just passing through. In fact, the scripture tells us in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 1, we have a building from God. It's an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Is that not encouraging? Well, if you didn't have anything to praise the Lord about when you came in, you have something to praise the Lord about. If you think about this building, not made with hands, that we have in heaven, I'm going to spend eternity there. You know why? Because this is just my temporary home.
Sometimes I feel like I'm just walking around with my head up in the clouds. I'm steady moving, but I'm not gaining ground. Headed the wrong way in a crowd. Then I remember I'm not part of this world. I'm moving higher each day. Upward mobility sounds mighty good to me, and I just can't wait to get away. I got to remember I'm not here to stay. I'm looking forward to a brighter day. I got to remember I'm not here for long. I'm just living in my temporary home.
Now these walls might look permanent, and these chairs might look permanent, but this here is temporary, and it's all going to fade away, because we got a home in glory waiting on us.
If you are bothered by the problems of life, don't you let them get you down. Just just look to Jesus, you will not be denied. Who are you up to higher ground? Don't you forget, you're a child of the King, and you're an heir to his throne. We may not know just when, but he's coming back again to take us to our happy home, y'all. I got you, remember, I'm not here to stay. I'm looking forward to a brighter day. I got you, remember, I'm not here for long. I'm just living in my temporary home. I got you, remember, I'm not here to stay. I'm looking forward to a brighter day. I got you, remember, I'm not here for long.
I've been giving you a word of the week every week, and the word of the week for this week is courage. Have courage. I like what Mark Twain said. Courage is resistance to fear, and the mastery of fear. It's not the absence of fear. I thought that was a great truth, because sometimes we think, well, if I have courage, that means I don't fear anything. No, we are all going to fear certain things, but it's the mastery of it. That's when you really have courage. Courage, that's a great word. Committing to courage is about committing to taking steps forward even when it's uncomfortable. That's what courage is. I hope you'll think about that this week. Hey, this Wednesday is our last week of our concert series, and so I want to invite you to be here to hear the Hobsons. It's 10 o'clock. Don't have to have a ticket. We'll take an offering for them. And then afterwards, we're going to have a luncheon for our widows. But widows, please make sure you get a ticket. They'll be available in the gathering place after the service if you didn't get it. But today's the last day to get one, so we'll be able to prepare well for you. Let's stand together and let's shout to the Lord this morning.
We're going to shout to the Lord because he is worthy of our praise, our Savior, our refuge, and our tower. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you.
Shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing, power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Hallelujah.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love.
Oh, you're my comfort,
my comfort,
and my shelter,
my shelter.
And strength.
Let
God, I thank you this morning for the promise that we have in you. And you recorded it in your word so that if we forget about it, if our mind starts to slip a little bit, we won't ever forget it because we can look in your word and be reminded of the truth that our promise of eternity as a Christ follower is secured in heaven. I thank you for the foundation of God's word that helps us to rely on that promise. God, may you today minister to our hearts. I look around this room, Lord Jesus, and I think of the burdens on hearts, the needs in lives, the physical bodies that need to be touched even as they sit here this morning. I think of other folks that are watching on our online streaming who this morning just want to reach out and feel you touching them, and I pray that you would. Lord, I thank you that this morning we can shout to the Lord, thanking you of all of your blessings. They just don't ever seem to stop. And I thank you for that. God, would you help us this morning to listen on purpose? Could it just be that the reason any of us are here today is that you have a word just for us? Whether anybody around us needs it, help us to be able to say, not my brother, but my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, that needs to hear from you today. God, would you get glory in this service for Jesus' sake? And everybody said, amen. Thank you. Be seated. This morning I begin a brand new series with you. I've looked forward to sharing with you. And I'm taking it from Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1 this morning. The scripture says this: we must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we don't drift away. Wow. Do you think that it's possible that we who are Christ followers could drift away from what we know? Apparently so. And I want to just kind of take that verse this morning and hone into it and tell you what Jesus would like to undo this morning, what he would like to undo. Our ushers are getting in their place and they're going to serve us this morning. Thank you for your faithfulness in giving toward our building fund, building toward the construction of our video wall, we pray, and then the ongoing needs of our church. One of the things that will become true as we get in the new building is that we take on a separate lease, a whole new lease, some new obligations. So please don't slack up in your faithfulness in tithing and giving, and thank you for that. Our boys and girls are slipping out to the kids' zone. I believe God can do everything we need for him to do in this place because he promises in his word he'll do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or what? Think. Whatever you can think of, God can do more than what you can think of. Isn't that amazing? And he will. He will. So this morning as we give together, I want you to know prayer changes everything. It really does. It changes it all. Father, we give because we've asked you to do a mighty work in this place. And so we give toward that goal, thanking you can do exceeding abundantly above all we ask or think in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Just before they begin to play, you know this week is the eclipse. You have your glasses? Got mine ready. I'm ready for it. Somebody said, you look good in dark glasses. That's why I wear them. Seriously, if you are driving, the word is don't look up while you're driving. Look down at the road. Somewhere between 1:30 and 4:30 would be kind of a dangerous time. So I hope you have your glasses if you're going to look at it. Do you know what kind of underwear to wear during the eclipse? Fruit of the moon. So be sure you have your... Wear your fruit of the moon underwear. Hey, would you give a hand to our band over here? Thank you all. Probably everybody remembers the craze a few years ago when we were wearing these What Would Jesus Do? WWJD armbands. In fact, if you were here a little over a year ago, we even gave one to everybody in a service during a particular message I was preaching. But it all started in 1896 when a man named Charles Sheldon wrote the book that you see on the screen, In His Steps. And in that book, he says this, In His Steps, he says, whenever you're facing difficult decisions or questions in your life, you ought to ask yourself, well, what would Jesus do? And that's how you come to an answer. You don't know what to do about something, well, what would Jesus do? The book kind of lay dormant for a number of years. In fact, it was 100 years later when J.D. Finkelberg, a youth worker at the Calvary Evangelical Church in Calgary, Canada, picked up the book and read it. Just a young girl, it was 100 years old when she read the book, and she got the idea, wouldn't this be something to try to tell teenagers? Hey, teenagers, you're going through some struggles in life. Why don't you go through those struggles by asking yourself the question about everything, what would Jesus do? And she's the one who first had the armbands made up and then began to distribute them first to her youth group, and then people saw them and wanted them, people saw them and wanted them, and it became a mass production, and millions of these little armbands were made because of that. I've often wondered, what would Jesus, though, undo in our culture today? In our culture today, what would he undo? There's so many things that have been done, maybe some of them even done in Jesus' name, that Jesus would say, well, excuse me, I had nothing to do with that. And if I had my way, I would come back to earth and I would undo it. So my question to you in this series is not what would Jesus do, but what would Jesus undo? On October the 31st, 1983, the Korean Airlines KAL flight 007 left New York for Seoul, Korea, with a stopover in Anchorage, Alaska to refuel. No problem getting from New York to Anchorage, but when they got to Anchorage, they shut the plane off for a refueling and a long period of stop. They actually let the passengers disembark and got back on. When they did and started the plane again, unbeknownst to anybody, there was a malfunction on the plane in the flight navigation system. And so without anybody knowing there was a malfunction in the flight navigation system, the plane takes off from Anchorage, Alaska, headed for Seoul, Korea. But it was only off by 1.5%. So for 100 miles, nobody even noticed that the plane was off course. It wasn't until the plane was off 200 miles that people began to say, we have a problem here. In fact, they began to pass through Soviet airspace. And as they did, the Soviet Air Command tried to reach them by way of radio, but with no success. And so the Soviet sent two jet planes with missiles. And when they got no response, they shot down flight 007, and 286 passengers died in that. All because they had done what? They had drifted off course. Because they had drifted off course by 200 miles, they were totally out of the space where they were allowed to be and needed to be. Sometimes when you and I drift off the space where we're supposed to be, things happen that we wish wouldn't happen, and sometimes disaster happens. That's why I'm using this verse in Hebrews chapter 2 as I launch this series today, and I want to go over it again with you. We must pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we don't drift away. And by drifting away, I'm talking about the phrase, so that we don't drift away. You see, this room is full of people. Are you listening?
Yes.
This room is full of people who remember the 50s, don't we? Things were different in the 50s. There were a lot of things in the 50s that aren't true today. But what happened from the 50s? Things began to change about the 60s, didn't they? And then from the 60s to the 70s, things changed a lot more. From the 70s to the 80s, things changed a whole lot more. And from the 80s to the 90s, things changed even more than that. And from the 90s to today, we say this, we've come a long way, baby. But we've drifted a long way in the wrong direction, haven't we? Amen. We're no place near where we started just in the 1950s, things have changed. Back in the 50s, we actually prayed for each other in difficult times. We walked through trials with each other. Back in the 50s, people actually had a Bible and read it. We prayed together as families back in the 50s. Our children were safe in school. We were safe to go to the airport. We were safe to go to a mall. We didn't have to have security in a church building. In fact, back in the 50s, if you had a permit for a concealed weapon, it's only because you were in law enforcement. And now, too many people in this room have one that don't know how to use it. And it scares me. Things have changed. And they changed because America's drifted. All the things that were true in the 50s, mostly the things that were changed in the 50s aren't true anymore. We've drifted off course, and because we've drifted off course, we did it slowly. Nobody intended on purpose, I don't think, to go that way. It just happened. We drifted away. Let me kind of visualize by giving you a scripture of what happened. The Bible tells us this. It says, don't move the ancient boundary stone that was set by your ancestors. Now, here's what happened. Many years ago, when you bought a piece of land, you would put a stone there, like you see there, and that would mark your piece of property. And sometimes they would even inscribe over there the Wilson family on this side, and on this side, the Jones family. And so you knew if you're the Wilson family, you're on that side of the stone. If you're the Jones family, you're on that side of the stone. And people would have those stones to mark their boundaries. I'm sure as a surveyor, you've probably seen some of those stones. Some of them still exist in places. But here's what the scripture is saying. Don't move the ancient boundaries that were set by your ancestors. There were some things that were set even as early as the 50s that we have moved the boundaries. And what was right in the 50s is no longer right, and what was wrong in the 50s is no longer wrong. You know what we've done? We have taken the boundary, the ancient boundary, and we've moved it. And so we've moved a little closer and a little closer and a little closer to what was wrong. We were a long way away from it in the 50s, but we've gotten a whole lot closer to it in 2024. As a matter of fact, you know what's happened in 2024? This was right, that was wrong, and now it's over here. We've gone so far that what used to be wrong now seems right. We've left the Judeo-Christian philosophy that our country was founded on, where God is God and there's one God, where the Bible is true and it's only true, and every bit of it's true, and there's no error found in it. We've left those principles. We've left those principles in the church. We no longer have the same doctrines in many of the churches. We've left the doctrine of the church. If I were to mention this morning the word holiness, half of you would say, what are you talking about? Holiness, what in the world is that? You know why you don't know? Because it's not talked about in the church anymore. We've changed from the doctrinal truths to cultural truths, and we preach cultural truths, and we've forgotten the doctrinal truths, and we're so far past what is right, we don't even know anymore what's right and what's wrong. Our homes have moved away from spiritual priorities. Individually, we've moved away from the nearness of God. And when movement begins and change happens, it picks up speed, and it picks up speed quickly. Before long, you look back and you say, wow, what happened? What happened to the America I grew up in? My wife was saying recently she feels sorry for our grandchildren. And we do feel sorry for them. They can't go safely to some of the places that we went. Some of the places that we used to go. Now you say, I'm not dare going there myself, let alone take my children or my grandchildren. It's not safe. The most elite shopping mall in Metro Atlanta when we lived there was a place we would go and like, wow, just look, it's elite. And now you don't even dare go there. We've come a long way, baby, but we've come a long way in the wrong direction. Because drifting, here's what drifting says. Drifting says, I'm no longer in control. And nobody's in control anymore. Our country is out of control. Our churches are out of control. Our homes are out of control. And unfortunately, individually, I'm afraid we're out of control as well. We're drifting and we don't even know and realize we're drifting. Nobody decided, let's go there. Nobody even decided this is where we want to go. We just drifted. And more than any other generation in society, our generation has drifted further in the fastest period of time than any generation has ever drifted. Spiritually, drifting is so dangerous. I'm convinced that it's something that Jesus would undo if he could come back. If Jesus could come back, I'm positive he would undo where the wrong and the right are, and he would do them back where they are. Amen. He would undo it. But see, he's giving us a choice, hasn't he? Amen. And here's the unfortunate part, but the truth, we get to choose, but then we don't get to choose the consequences. We got to choose whether we wanted right or wrong. We just don't get to choose the consequences of having chosen right and wrong. So this morning, I want to share with you some truths that I hope will land in your mind and land in your heart. But Noah drifted in his prosperity, and he wasn't even aware of his nakedness. Samson drifted in his strength, and he wasn't even aware of his powerlessness. And I'm afraid that if we aren't careful, we will drift spiritually and yet not even be aware that we've drifted. That's the sad part, that we aren't even aware of it. So mark down some things. They're on your worship program. I didn't even make you fill in the blank. I filled it in for you. But the reality of drifting. The writer of Hebrews was saying this. Here's what the writer of Hebrews. We don't know who wrote Hebrews. We think Steve Duke did, but we're not sure. The writer of Hebrews was saying this. Are you hearing me? I'm writing this to the Hebrews to get them to stop acting like Hebrews. Now, what were the Hebrews acting like? Well, they would get the power of God in their life. They would get the glory of God in their life, and then they'd forget about it. And then they would have to pay a penalty for getting about it. And then they would get it again, then they'd forget about it. In fact, they went 490 years without even worshiping God. And God said, you owe me 490 years worth of Sabbath, so I'm going to collect it by letting the Babylonians take you into captivity for 70 years, and I'm going to collect on the 490 years you didn't worship me. Oh, okay, well, we will now. Okay, but you forgot about it. I'll take you out of Egypt, out of bondage, and I'll get you headed toward the promised land. But when you get to the wilderness, you forgot about that I had brought you out of captivity and out of slavery. And you forgot about that I brought you food every morning and every night. And you forgot that your shoes aren't even wearing out. And so guess what? Because you stopped worshiping me in the wilderness, you aren't going. And all of you are going to die, except for two, before you even get there. And even Moses isn't going to get there because he disobeyed me at the rock. I'll let him see it. But he said, listen, I'm writing to the Hebrews to get the Hebrews to stop acting like Hebrews. And I'm saying to you this morning, I think Jesus is writing to you and me and saying, I'm writing to the Christians to get you to stop acting like the world. And if I could come back and undo it, I would undo where you are because it used to be better than where you are right now. The writer is giving us the image of drifting away. And the Greek word here is like a flowing river. And there's a fast current. The image I get is a sailboat that's at a dock, but it's not moored. It's not tied up. And so the rope of the boat is laying across the dock, but it's not tied up anyplace. Now, if you walk away for 5 minutes and you come back, probably the boat is still there and the rope is still laying across the dock. But if you walk away for 8 hours, the boat will have drifted out in the water. And that's what happened to us. You remember the rest of this verse here, he's talking about don't drift away and forget your so great salvation. You remember when you got saved? You remember how you're, wow, this God gave me this? You mean I get this in heaven too? Have you forgotten about it? Have you drifted from that moment? I say it all the time. God, don't ever let me forget what you did when you transformed me. I don't want to get away from that moment. But we're drifting. And we don't even realize we're drifting. Hebrews says we're going to have to pay the most careful attention, therefore, to what we've heard so that we don't drift away. Therefore, what's he talking about? Therefore. Therefore, because you know who Jesus is. Therefore, because you know he's your Redeemer. Therefore, because you know what he did for you. Therefore, because you know what he died, that he died on the cross. Therefore, don't forget about it. Because if you forget, you'll just start drifting away. That's the value every day of being in the Word. It's God's reminder to you what he does, what he's done for you, and what he's still doing for you, and what he's going to do for you. And if you get away from this, you'll drift, I promise you. That's the reality. Here's the reason for drifting: inattention. We just stop paying attention to it. When I was in college, I was not a student. I went to party is what I went for. And got in Sigma Chi and got messed up really bad. And I partied. And I didn't, I sometimes I went to class and sometimes I didn't. And when I would go, I'd been up so late the night before that I'd sometimes fall asleep in class. But I'd look around and saw the rest of the students, so I didn't feel bad about it. But the teachers had a way of getting our attention. And I don't know, I think if you're a teacher, you must go, while you're in studying to be a teacher, they must teach you this. Because after a while, the teacher would say, listen, what I'm about to tell you, you'll be responsible for on a test. And we'd all wake up. What you've been saying up to now wasn't very important. In fact, we were bored to tears. But if this is going to be, if I'm going to be responsible for it, I want to listen. That's what Jesus is saying. You're going to be responsible for this. I want you to pay all the more attention. I want you to listen because you're going to be responsible for it. And the readers to the letter of Hebrews, they weren't giving attention to their salvation experience. Here's what they were doing. They were saying, got saved, check. What's next? Well, to be obedient to me, you need to be baptized by immersion. Okay, got baptized, check. What next? Well, you really, 10% of everything that I bless you with is a tithe, and you give it back to the Lord. Tithe, check. Okay, I got my check marks in, and so I'm done. And that's kind of what they were doing. Check. I got the major things, check, so I'm done. And they began to drift away. And I see it in the church all the time. You get saved, you get baptized, you begin to tithe, and then it's check, I got my checks. And so then you begin to drift. And things that used to be important aren't important anymore. And we begin to drift away. In fact, the Hebrew writer, he'll address them. He said, you even, later he's going to say, you've even started neglecting faithful worship. You remember when you first got saved, you couldn't wait to get to church. And now you can't wait to get out. You're neglecting things. We pastored a church in Atlanta for 31 years. We were pastored there 31 years. And one of the churches where we were, we went to two services on Sunday morning, but we were having a Sunday night service with full choir and everything, a Wednesday night service with full choir and all. But we went down to one service on Sunday night. But on Sunday night, you had to come 30 minutes early just to get a seat, and then we put chairs in the aisle along with the pews. Man, but you know what began to happen? We moved into a new building. We built a new building large enough so that we didn't have to have two services, so that we could have plenty of room. And you know what people started doing? Drifting. You know what became popular? Travel ball. And they were traveling on the weekends for the kids to play ball. And we started drifting from what we knew, drifting from what was important. This used to be the most important hour in your life, but you've drifted from it. It used to be everything you scheduled around worshiping the Lord. No, it's not. We have drifted from what was important. You do that in marriage, and it won't be long, you'll lose your marriage. You do that with your health, it won't be long, you'll lose your health. You don't pay attention to your bank book, and it won't be long, you'll be writing bad checks. We need to pay attention. We need to pay attention, or we're going to drift from what's really important. We need to pay attention to our fellowship with Jesus, because if we don't pay attention to our fellowship with Jesus, we'll start drifting and have other kinds of fellowship, which are more important to us than the fellowship with Jesus. Hello? Here's number three, the result of drifting. Why is drifting such a dangerous thing? Well, I've listed a few things. One is when we drift, our impairment, our discernment is impaired. He says, pay attention to what you've heard. Don't be casual in your walk with Christ. Paying attention is a choice we have to make. See, here's what can happen. You can come to church and sit here. You can listen to the sounds. You can hear a song. You can hear my voice. You can hear whatever. And you can listen and not really hear it. Go to the next slide. This is what I see from my view. You're listening, kind of, but you're not hearing. In Mark chapter 14, Jesus talks about going to the Garden of Gethsemane. And he left his disciples to pray. And he came back and they were what? They were asleep. They were asleep. Have some of you, I'm talking about in this service, but have some of you just kind of gone to sleep in your walk with Jesus? I love him. I know he loves me. I know he's doing what he's doing for me. But yeah, if you aren't careful, your discernment can be impaired. In 1952, engineers learned that people were going to sleep at the wheels while driving, and they put these rumple strips on the road so that as you went to sleep and began to drift either way, it would wake you up. You ought to ride with my wife. Most of the ride. I'm kidding. Drifting was seen in the life of Lot, wasn't it? Lot started drifting toward the prosperity of Sodom and Gomorrah, and look what happened to him. Samson started drifting toward the pleasures of women, and look what happened to him. David started drifting toward leisure, and look what happened to him. Peter didn't mean to deny the Lord. He just drifted along with that crowd. Once he got with that crowd, warming his hands around the enemy fire, I really don't think Peter intended to go there. Nobody was more declarative of their love for Jesus than Peter. Remember in the upper room? I'll die for you. The others may leave you, but not me. I don't think he intended to do that. He just drifted over there with the enemy's fire. And if you and I aren't careful, we drift over with the enemy's fire, and then we get to the place where, are you a Christian? Well, yeah, I go to church. And we become no different from Peter. Drifting always begins at a moment we lose sight of the Lord. Be careful that you don't, when you don't pay careful attention. Here's the second thing. We drift. Decisions are in question when we drift. Solomon wrote this in Proverbs, like a bird that flees in his nest is anyone who flees from home. The word flee there is the word drift. Have you ever thought about how cattle escape a fenced-in area? Have you ever thought about it? They just keep finding another clump of grass, then another clump of grass, then another clump of grass, and all of a sudden, they're at a place where there's a hole in the fence, and they see another clump of grass that's through the hole, and they just go over there. They don't stand there and say, "Hey, Bessie, all of you, come over here. I found a hole." They don't do that. They're just looking for another clump of grass. And they don't even know when they're outside the fence. They don't even know it. They just drifted over there because there was another clump of grass. And that's what happens too many times to us. We don't know. We just, oh, that's a good looking clump of grass, and that's another good looking clump of grass. And before we know it, we drifted outside of the fence. Such was the case with Elijah when he got discouraged. Remember what the angel said? What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? What are you doing sitting under a juniper tree with your lip hanging down all discouraged? What are you doing? Well, you just drifted here, didn't you? You think the prodigal son intended when he left home to wind up feeding hogs? You think he intended that? No, as a matter of fact, if you read the whole story, it says he got down there feeding the hogs, and all of a sudden it says this, he came to himself. He realized he had drifted, didn't he? Sometimes we got to get to the hog slop to know that we've drifted. That's pretty sad, but that's so true. No, Demas, you remember? Demas was a faithful guy. But what did Paul say? Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world more. How do you walk with Paul and all of a sudden you drift? Clump here and a clump there and a clump there. And before you know it, Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world more than he loved serving the Lord. If only we in cattle understood that offense is never erected to deprive us. Offense is erected to protect us. It's always true. When sin moves in, sanity always moves out. The great preacher G.K. Chesterton said this, never move a fence until you find out why it was put up. Never move a boundary until you find out why it was put up. The boundary was put up to keep you from drifting. We've all had, who have children, we've all gone through it with our kids. Why can't I do this, Mama? Why can't I do that, Daddy? Because I built a fence, not to deprive you, but to protect you. I remember my oldest son one day said, can I go so-and-so? And I said, no. He said, Dad, everybody's going. I said, no, everybody's not. He said, yeah, they are. I said, no, they're not. He said, how do you know? I said, because you're not going. So everybody's not going. Don't move a fence till you find out what the fence was put up for. It's not to deprive you. It's to protect you. Here's the third thing. We drift. Disaster is inevitable. You remember Acts 27? Paul was on the ship. They get to the island of Malta and they can't get to the island. A big storm comes up. Here's what it says they did. They cut the anchors. They were anchored down, but they cut the anchor. And when they cut the anchors, they started drifting. And when they started drifting, they had a colossal shipwreck. And the whole ship came apart. They were barely saved. Scripture says they lost all control of the ship. They became like a cork bobbling in the water, and the result was a terrible shipwreck. Drifting always has the opposite effect of what we think it'll have. Solomon drifted toward the pleasure of many women. It was miserable in his life. There's a lot of examples I could give you this morning, and I don't have time, but I am going to give you one of somebody who drifted, and it's a name that many of you will recognize. His name is Bob Harrington. Bob Harrington was known as the chaplain of Bourbon Street. During his days, there was nobody any more popular as an evangelist except Billy Graham. Nobody drew larger crowds than Bob Harrington except Billy Graham. He positioned himself in New Orleans at Bourbon Street, called himself the chaplain of Bourbon Street. People on Bourbon Street were getting saved. Dancers were getting saved. Bartenders were getting saved. He had an incredible, incredible outreach ministry there. But there came a time where Bob Harrington, I'm using his words now, got too big for my britches. And I began to think, I am something. He began to say to cities, I'll come there if you will guarantee me so much money and guarantee such a large arena. And if they wouldn't, he wouldn't go. He became enamored with his own success. He became enamored with money and fame and fortune. He used to use a famous phrase when he would preach. He'd say, stay close to Jesus or you'll get close to the devil. The problem was he didn't listen to his own preaching. And he didn't stay close to Jesus, and he got close to the, he drifted close to the devil. He lost his family. He lost his wife. His daughter, Rhonda, married a preacher, but didn't want anything to do with her dad. His wife left him. It wasn't until the later years of his life when his daughter, who had married a preacher, took him in and helped him to redeem himself with the Lord. He never intended to drift there. He made some horrible choices and chose sin and rebellion over obedience and repentance, and he lost everything. And I'm going to quote him in the next line. Here's what he said. I just slowly drifted into sin until I, in effect, flipped God a bird. Only Billy Graham drew greater crowds. Only Billy Graham was a greater evangelist in those days. But he drifted. The Lord is gracious to allow us the freedom to choose, but we have to accept the consequences of our choices. And when our drifting is picked up on the enemy's radar, he'll start hurling his darts at us. There's voluntary drifting and there's involuntary drifting. Involuntary drifting is when we just aren't aware of what's happening. We just start spending more time with the wrong crowd. We just start spending more time doing the wrong things. We're just trying to be a good friend, a good neighbor, a good whatever. And it's the drifting is involuntary at that point. But it comes a time where we do it on purpose and we realize what we've done, and then it becomes voluntary. Drifting doesn't require any effort at all. All you have to do is just stop rowing and you'll drift. If you stop rowing, you're going to drift. You stop growing spiritually, you're going to drift spiritually. You stop rowing in a boat, you'll drift. You stop rowing in your spiritual life, you'll drift. Doesn't take any effort. And you never drift upstream. We always drift downstream. It's an interesting story about Jonah. You remember Jonah? God wanted him to go to Nineveh and preach. Instead of going to Nineveh and preach, he goes down and catches a ship and goes to Joppa. It's an interesting story because it says he went down to Joppa. He went down to the boat. He went down in the belly of the whale. When we drift, we always go down. You never say, you know, Bill, he went up to being an alcoholic. When we start going downstream, the speed increases too. Listen, if you're on a raft and you hear the noise of the waterfall, it's getting ready to pick up quick. And also, drifting is dangerous to others. When a boat starts drifting, it's dangerous to all the other boaters. And hear me carefully, grandparents and parents. When you and I start drifting, it affects our children and our grandchildren.
Amen.
Most drifting ends in a shipwreck. Boats that drift typically will run into another boat and wreck. My picture that I have in my mind is a child putting his little sailboat in the water. It doesn't have a string on it, and once the current of the water begins to ripple, the sailboat begins to go out. And he has no idea, but the farther it goes, the farther it is from his grasp, the farther it is from home, and the more difficult it'll be to ever get it back. Can I make an analogy? When you and I start drifting, if we're not tethered to the Lord and his word, we'll just keep drifting farther and farther and farther. And hear me, it'll be harder and harder to ever get back. Catch it when it's not very far. The remedy for drifting, and I'll quit. I wouldn't give you a problem without giving you a remedy. The writer of Hebrews was giving a remedy here. He said, listen again to the scripture. We must pay attention to what we've heard so we don't drift away. Look at me. All I can do on Sunday morning is tell you. Only thing can happen in a small group is the teacher can tell you. Only thing can happen is a Bible study is somebody can tell you. That's all. That's the value. But the problem is sometimes when you just listen, you get information overload. And the scripture doesn't pat us on the back for having information overload. As a matter of fact, just the opposite. It says, don't be a hearer only, be a doer of the word. All I can do is tell you what Jesus says to do. You have to decide to do it. And the remedy is not just listening. The remedy is doing what the Holy Spirit speaks to you about doing. We've got to listen. We've got to do. We've got to do what he said. The expression, what we've heard, refers back to what did you hear that caused you to come to a faith in Christ? What was that? Well, we got to get back to that. Don't stray from that. Don't drift from that. So what's the remedy? The remedy is keep rowing. Just keep rowing. Don't stop. Listen, I share this often because some of you don't have a plan in the morning when you get up, so I just tell you often what my plan is. I get up in the morning and I read 5 Psalms and I read a proverb. The whole chapter of Proverbs. I read the proverb of the day. There's 31 proverbs, so whatever day of the month, today's the 7th. I got up this morning, I read Proverbs 7. You know what I was looking for? I was looking for something today to keep me rowing, keep me growing. Then I read five psalms. I started with Psalm 7, skipped 30 to Psalm 37, skipped 30 to Psalm 67, skipped 30 to Psalm 67, 97, skipped 30 to Psalm 127. So by doing that, I read all 150 psalms every month too. Five a day, skip 30, five a day. And you know what I got today? You know what I got from Proverbs? Wisdom. Don't let wisdom get away from you. Wisdom. See, sometimes I'll get to a word when I'm reading, and I'll just stop. I'm honest with you that I might not read the whole chapter. If I get to a word and it smites me, and it strikes my heart, the Lord says, just stop right there. That's all you can handle today. And for today, all I was going to be able to handle this morning when I got the word wisdom, I read the rest of it, but I kept going back to wisdom. As a matter of fact, in Proverbs 7, he talks about a prostitute. And he said, a prostitute will lure you away, but wisdom will keep you from her. I'm trying to keep rowing every day. Because if I don't keep rowing, you know what I'll do? I'll drift. And if I drift, you know who it affects? My marriage, my children, my grandchildren, and ultimately you. I got to keep rowing. But you do too. You put your britches on the same way I do. You eat with a fork just like I do. Some of you use a spoon, but... What he's saying is, listen to 2 Peter 1. Make every effort to add to your faith. Good character. That's what rowing is, adding to your faith. Don't get to a place and say, man, I'm done. I've got this thing. No, you don't. You got to keep rowing. You got to keep adding to your faith. And if you don't keep adding to your faith, you keep rowing, you're not going to be growing. And if you're not rowing and you're not growing, you're drifting. We're either making progress toward Christ and his likeness, or we're going away from him. Here's the second thing. Watch out for undercurrents. Watch out for undercurrents. That's another value this morning of wisdom for me. Because you know what? The undercurrents will draw you away, but wisdom will keep you on track. There's the undercurrent of temptation. That's what Proverbs 7 was talking about, the temptation of another woman. But wisdom will keep you on track. There's the undercurrent even of good things. Did you know good things can be an undercurrent? Yeah. They can. You can get so involved in good things that you miss the best thing. Don't get caught up in the good things. That, you know, I'm not doing anything bad. You cannot be doing anything bad and still not be doing anything as best you could. I'll tell you another undercurrent is busy. Corrie ten Boom said this, if the devil can't get you to be bad, he'll get you to be busy. You know why? Because if you're busy, you can't be getting good. Because you're so busy that you stop rowing and you stop growing. Here's the third thing, the effect to go against the tide. You got to expect to go against the tide. You can't just flow. If you flow, you're going to drift. We sometimes think only teenagers have peer pressure, but that's not true. We all have peer pressure. And sometimes you got to go against the peer pressure. You got to go against the tide. You got to watch it or you're going to drift. And then the fourth thing, you make sure you have a strong anchor. I've never been a boater. I really don't know anything about boating, so I had to do a little study for what I'm going to tell you now. I didn't know there were different kinds of anchors. I really didn't know that. And to choose the best anchor to use on your boat, you've got to know what the soil is underneath the water. I didn't know that. Is it muddy? Is it grassy? Is it sandy? Is it clay? What kind of soil is it? Because that makes a difference on what kind of anchor you get. There's a fluke anchor. There's a flow anchor. A blow anchor, excuse me. And there's a palm anchor. One of them is good in mud. One of them is good in sand. One of them is good in clay. And if you get the wrong kind of anchor, you'll just keep dragging. You can throw your anchor out, but if it won't catch a hold, you just keep going. One of them is good in rocks. And sometimes you hit a rock, and then you back up your boat, and it comes unhooked, and then it'll reset itself. They don't all reset themselves. We got to make sure we have a good anchor. You know what my anchor is? My anchor is My anchor is in God's word. It's settled. It won't change. See, those anchors will change, and you have to change them. But God's word is settled forever in heaven, the Bible says, and it's not going to change. It doesn't matter if you have a fluke anchor or a palm anchor. A bucket of concrete's a good anchor, but not for a boat. It is for a body. But you got to make sure you got the right anchor. And you better have the right anchor spiritually. Hey, listen, it's not confusing spiritually. It's confusing to me in a boat. But it's not spiritually. The hymn writer said, we have an anchor that keeps the soul steadfast and sure while the billows roll, fastened to the rock which cannot be moved, grounded firm and deep in the Savior's love. Hebrews chapter 6 says, God wanted to make this unchanging nature, his purpose, clear. So he confirmed it with an oath that it's impossible for God to lie. And we have this hope. You know what my hope is? God can't lie. You know what he said to me? I'm not yet 21 years old, and I'm listening. And he said, if you'll admit you're a sinner and ask me to forgive you, I will save you and give you eternal life. And so I took him at his word. I believed God was telling the truth. I hadn't read it in the Bible yet. I just believed that it was the truth. So I did it. I admitted I was a sinner. I asked him to forgive me and save me. And then I found out later, he said, whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And you know what? He can't lie. So if you call on his name and ask him to save you, he either has to save you or else he is a liar. And since Hebrews says he can't lie, well, then that's settled, isn't it? Isn't that a pretty good anchor? Yes. Man, I can sink my teeth into that. What happens when we drift? We don't even realize it. We don't even realize it. Have you ever gone to the beach and put your pillow or your blanket and stuff out on the beach? And you're out in the water and you're just bobbing, you know, just bobbing. And you're having fun. And you're just bobbing along in the water. And all of a sudden you say, oh, there's my towel up there. There it is up there. And you say, how'd I get down here? How'd I get down here? How did some of you get to where you are today, spiritually? See, as long as we could see our towel, we thought we were okay, didn't we? You keep that up, before long, you won't even see where your towel was. If you don't stop, you're drifting. You'll be so far away, it'd be hard to get back. How did we get there? We were just being comfortable. It was just familiar. Richard Stearns and his wife work with World Vision. They'd gone to a little town in South Africa. They pulled up their car, and as they pulled up their car, there were kids playing soccer. They hadn't seen many cars come by, and so they all leave their soccer game and they come surround the car. And Richard's wife sees the boys there with what they called a soccer ball. It was just a bunch of rags with tape around them and some string to hold the rags together. And that was her soccer ball. And she said to them, hey, listen, I have a deal for you. If you'll give me your soccer ball, I'll give you mine. And they looked at her through the car window. And one of the boys who was holding the soccer ball said, be right back. He goes over and he gets with his buddies who are playing soccer. Takes him a while. He finally comes back and he said, okay, trade. And she says in their book, He Walks Among Us, said, I couldn't figure out why that was such a hard trade. How much fun could playing soccer with a bundle of rags tied up, how much fun could that be opposed to playing with a real soccer ball? I couldn't understand it. She said, it took me a while. And then I realized they were familiar with this. They were comfortable with it. This was going to be a change. That's what happens to us. We get comfortable. We get familiar. And Jesus says, you don't want to trade that in for me? You got to think about that. You really having that much fun? Because I have joy unspeakable. I want you to bow your heads. I want to ask you this morning to just be honest with yourself, honest with God. Have you become so comfortable with your drift that you haven't realized where you are? What would Jesus do if he came back today? Oh, I think he would undo our drifting. I think he would reestablish our boundary stone. I think he would remind us of Hebrews. Pay attention. Pay attention. Remember what it was like when you got saved. Wasn't that sweet? But you've drifted. And you've drifted to where you just become comfortable with the status quo. And this morning, through his Holy Spirit, he is speaking to us saying, would you trade in your drifting for being close with me again? And that's my question to you this morning. I'm going to ask our ladies to sing, and when they sing, I'm going to ask you to deal with that question. If you've drifted and you realize it, are you ready to say, hey, I'm aware now. I didn't realize how easy it was to drift. And in Jesus' name, I want to get my anchor settled this morning. And I'm going to invite you to declare that this morning by just standing where you are, if that's you. You could sit back down after that, but you're standing is my declaration. I have drifted. I realize that. And I got comfortable with it. And I want the sweetness and the joy that I know is mine with Jesus.
I'm caught up in
sorry when I've gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. Open up my heart. I'm sorry.
Take us back to the beginning. The day our heart was broken, we understood we were weak, could not navigate on our own, and could not get to heaven by any of our own means. We bowed our heads humbly and said to Jesus, forgive me, take me. And oh, what a change took place. Burdens were lifted at Calvary. Sin vanished in a moment. Our sin of a lifetime was removed from us as far as the east is from the west. We knew heaven was our home, and we could say with the Apostle Paul, it makes no difference if I live or if I die, because if I live, Jesus is now with me, and if I die, I'm going to be with Jesus. Take us back to that beginning. Take us back there often. Because if we don't go back there often, we'll drift. And if we drift, there's too often a calamity at the other end. God, I know you're not coming back to undo. When you come back, everything will be changed. So the responsibility now, if we want to undo anything in our life, is up to us. God, help us to undo where we've drifted to and get back where we started from. Get our anchor solid in you. Lord, I pray you'll be pleased with our lives. Thank you for meeting with us today, Jesus. May your word be settled in our hearts as well as it is in heaven. In Jesus' sweet name, amen. Amen. You just quietly pass your communication cards to the aisle. Someone will collect them there. And while they're doing that, I just remind you, this week, Wednesday, is our concert series at 10 o'clock, and then Widows, our luncheon afterwards. So be sure, if you haven't gotten your ticket, you could get that in the gathering place before you leave today. But today has to be our last day so we can make arrangements. How many of you know God is good? What's your response? God is good? Yeah, and all the time God is good. So let's sing that together. Will you sing it with me? Voice. God is so good. I need to hear you. God is so good.
God is so good.
He's so good to me.
He's so good.
Let's stand together.
To me.
He's coming soon. Can you sing it?
He's coming soon. He's coming soon.
Even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus.
He's coming soon.
He's
so good to me.
Don't forget that as you live this week. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. Live for Jesus this week.